It works! It works! It works!
Excuse the cold open. This is a big day for me. It frickin' works, man. This has been quite the journey to get here. I was told after building the resonator it'd be about 1% of the work, with the other 99% getting an output. And I didn't believe them. Boy, am I an idiot. But we did it! There's not really much of a build in mind for this video. I'm more just gonna be, one, correcting some mistakes I made in my last video. Two, going over the build and how I got it to work. And three, burning stuff. So, if you don't care about the ins and outs and you just want to watch me burn stuff, go here. Now, I feel I should put a disclaimer here. I am by no means an expert on this. I'm just a dude who's been playing with a CO2 laser for a couple months. So, I'm fairly new to this subject, so don't take any of this as law, and if I make any mistakes, let me know in the comments. So I think first we should address the couple mistakes I made in the last video. First thing,
beautiful.
That's not an output. That is light from the plasma shining through the output coupler. These lasers run at 10,600 nanometers, which is far, far beyond what even a camera could pick up. So, my mistake. My second mistake is I called what was happening lasing. And while there could have been some lasing going on, I had no way to measure that or know that. All I achieved in the last video was a discharge across the tube. Now then, this tube has kind of evolved over the last couple months, and I stopped filming the build process because I did it a million times. And to be honest, I thought it was never gonna work. So, to explain what I got going on here, here's a cute little animation. So we start with our actual resonator tube, which is a 20 millimeter bore borosilicate glass tube. And this one is 4 feet long. Again, like the last tube, there's an acrylic tube for the water cooling jacket. Instead of having a separate machine cap for the water intake and outtake, I've just JB welded some barb fittings right into the tube. For the gas intake and outlet, as well as the electrical hookups, we have a machined aluminum part that slides into the acrylic tube and over the glass tube. There are two tapped holes in this. One for a number 10 screw for the electrical hookup. The second one for an 1/8 inch barb fitting. The bore on the end of this cap is machined to perfectly accept a 1/2 inch copper coupler to use as a sacrificial electrode, so it's easy to change out. There are three tapped holes on the end for mounting and adjusting the mirror plate, and we adjust the mirror by squashing an O-ring against the mirror. The back end gets a concave high reflector where the radius of the sphere that mirror is a part of is longer than the length of the resonator. The front end gets the exact same cap, but rather than a high reflector, it gets a zinc selenide partial reflector with 60% reflectivity, allowing some to pass through. So that's the basics of the new build. Let's see it in real life. Now on this tube, rather than relying on O-rings and pipe threads like the last one, everything is assembled with a liberal amount of JB Weld, which I found is great for filling up gaps and cracks. And we need to get a pretty dang good vacuum on this thing so no leaks are allowed. Having our slightly concave mirror on this side really helps with the gain of the tube because the photons reflected off of it will cross paths and hit more molecules if they're all centralized in the center of the tube. Now the larger bore diameter of the tube helps with two things. One, adjusting the mirrors is a whole lot easier and they go out of alignment a lot less. Two, with more space in the tube, it really increases the gain of the tube, so with each pass of photons, it is gaining more energy. The problem with a wider bore is the tube has to run at a much lower pressure than with a small bore tube. So you kind of got to find that money spot, which I found here at 20 millimeters. I'm still using the same Harbor Freight vacuum pump. I want to try it with fridge compressors now that I know it works. But now, one, I have a ball valve to shut off the pump so I don't have pump oil leaking back up into the tube. And two, there's a needle valve on the vacuum end and on the supply side. And having the two needle valves allows you to control the amount of gas in the tube at any given time. If there were no needle valve on the vacuum end, then the flow of the gas would be whatever the vacuum pump is pulling. But by choking that down, we can get our gas running at an optimum flow rate, which I don't have a number for. I just adjust the needle valves until It works. Which in some ways is better than having a number. Now then, alignment of the mirrors is one of the most critical parts of getting this laser to work. And as much as I hate to take this thing out of alignment, I'll do it. For the cause.
Oh man, this hurts me.
So in order to align this laser, we use a laser. This is a high power green laser pointer mounted on a pair of transit legs. Now, admittedly, this is not the best way to mount it. There have been many times where I accidentally kicked the thing and everything's out of alignment and I have to start from square one. But this is what I got set up now. I have a piece of cardstock hot glued to the front of the laser with just a little pinhole where the beam can exit. Now, people suggest you use a helium neon laser to align this, but any type of collimated laser will do. And if you're spending money on a helium neon laser, you might as well just buy a CO2 laser tube. Now we start by sticking a piece of masking tape over the front and back ends of the tube. Then we can turn our laser pointer on. Now we adjust our laser pointer to where it's shining right in the center of the bore. Now it's hard to tell on camera, but I have this lined up. Now we can poke a hole right in the center to allow the beam to pass through the tube. Now we have to adjust the laser pointer so it's shining through that hole on the front end of the tube and hitting the direct center of the bore on the back end. And you gotta check all the way along the tube, make sure it's not bouncing off the walls of the glass or anything. It's just gotta be straight through the tube, which we've already done. So now we just gotta do a minor adjustment to get it in the center. So now we've gotten it so that the dot is right in the center of the bore, we can take the masking tape off both ends. Now with the O-ring installed on the mirror, and making sure the mirror is clean, we can install it onto the back plate. And now by adjusting these three screws, we can adjust how the beam is reflected back. And once again, we want to have the beam reflected straight through the tube without bouncing off any walls. And as we get closer, we can start to see the beam reflected back on the cardstock on the laser pointer. Still unsure if you can see it on the camera, but now that we have the beam pointing back at the cardstock, we just align it to where it disappears into the pinhole where the beam comes out from. So now with our high reflector installed and aligned on the back, we can now install our partial reflector on the front. And again, with this, we adjust it until the beam lines up with the exit hole. Now I like to make sure it's good and tight, but don't go too tight. So I sure have broken a lot of optics and these are expansive. Now when you're adjusting the output coupler, you will start to see lines of reflections across here. And if you have it properly aligned, as you get closer and closer to the center, all those separate reflections will converge into one. And if they don't, your laser pointer is out of alignment with the tube and you have to start back from square one. But this looks pretty good where I have it right now. So now the last step that I like to do is I'll turn on the vacuum pump and make sure that the mirrors don't go out of alignment when a vacuum is pulled. This all looks pretty good, so we can move right along. So I just went through this whole sequence of using this Peltier unit to try and measure the wattage of the laser. And here's the number I came up with. 464,000 watts. I don't think that's right. So as of right now, I don't really know what the output of this laser is in watts. So if any of you guys have any good ideas on how I can measure the wattage, let me know down in the comments. Otherwise, let's move on to the fun part. It's laser time. So for our first material, you've already seen the wood burn, but I want to let it run for a good minute and see how much it will burn. Would you look at that? That is pretty dang cool, man. I'm gonna try the wood from further away. That'll do, man. It seems to be a pretty similar size. Can't really burst anything into flames. There we go. Let's try some acrylic. That smells absolutely awful. So if you can tell, we've made quite the little crater in the wood here. And we were definitely burning the acrylic, which is pretty cool. So for a while there, I was just wearing regular old safety glasses because the other laser goggles I got are annoyingly dark.
So, let's see what would have happened if I got this output straight to the eye. Good Lord. Ain't no city like toxicity. Oh, let's see them. Oh yeah, they're nice and melty. Yeah, that's a nice piece for the mantle. So here's my big I'm a freaking idiot moment. I just bought this lens and there's nowhere in town where I can get other lenses. And as I took it out of the package, I put it into the alligator clip to go get it set up. Popped right out, fell on the floor, broke in three pieces. So we're gonna try and use a half a lens. As a lens. We can't have a video that's all success on this channel, let's be honest. Oh! It seems to be working, kind of. Now for an iconic test that I saw on Jared Kinsey's channel. We're gonna try and make this thing spit hot lava. We're a little far. There we go. Now then, seeing as I'm kind of a dummy, and I really stick my fingers in places where they don't belong, I think we need a good finger analog. That'll do. On the bright side, this is the first thing I've burnt that smells good in here. Would you look at that crater? That looks delicious. I made you dinner.
I'm vegan.
Well, it smells absolutely horrendous in here. Ah, the smell of success. So after running the tube through those few tests, the water cooling seems to be working just great. None of it is all that hot. The end caps are a little bit warm, but not hot. So that's awesome. Now there is more fine tuning to do on this thing, but either way, I'm very, very pleased with where we got. Again, if you're trying to do this yourself, do not take me as an authority on the subject. Now, if you want more information about these lasers, I have two suggestions. One, Jared Kinsey's website for all things homemade laser. He's built quite a few CO2 lasers, among other cool stuff, and documented the process pretty well. He also has a YouTube channel where he posts videos of some of his experiments. Another great resource is Sam's Laser Fac, which has a whole thread about homemade CO2 laser tubes, with posts from a whole variety of different people who have built their own tubes who are much more well-versed in this than me and much smarter than me. So, both of those are great resources. Check them out. Otherwise, thanks for bearing with me. This project is unlike anything else that I've ever attempted. So it took me quite a while to get to this point, and I appreciate you all being patient. So thanks for that, and thanks for watching.